All right, thanks everybody. Good morning. So today we're going to have Dr. Samir Kashyap, who's an assistant professor here in Mayo Clinic, Florida. He's in the vascular team. Next slide, please. So he obtained his BA at the University of Kansas. Then he went on to get his medical degree at the Kansas City University of Medicine and Biosciences. He then did a pre-residency fellowship at the University of New Mexico, and then went on to residency at Riverside University. I do apologize, I made a mistake right there. He finished residency and is now a fellow of open cerebrovascular and endovascular surgery here at Mayo with us in Florida. And he got the rank of assistant professor of neurosurgery last year as well. You can see that he has a lot of academic awards that are highlighted down there. And then next slide, please. You're gonna see his most cited publications. So as you can see, he has been academically productive and highly cited, which is reflected in his H index of 8 right here. So next slide. Thank you, Samir, for presenting this morning with us. Your plaque is actually in the office, so next time you're around, I'll make sure to give it to you, and please take it away.
All right. Thank you for that introduction. I appreciate it. Let's see. Pulling up my presentation here. You see that okay?
Yes.
All right. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to talk to you this morning. What I wanted to talk about today was the topic of revascularization of chronic carotid occlusion and how we optimize patient selection for that. I have nothing to disclose. So, if you look at the recent statistics, about 750,000 people have ischemic strokes per year, and about 250,000 are diagnosed with TIAs per year. So I would even say that's an underestimate. But we have, you add that up, it's over about 1 million people per year experience some sort of ischemic event. And about 15 to 25% of those are attributed to ipsilateral chronic occlusions. And we know that the management of symptomatic carotid occlusive disease is well-researched and supported in literature. If you search carotid artery disease on PubMed, you get over 72,000 results. You have several studies discussing carotid endarterectomy, carotid stenosis, and there's very good data to support revascularization in that sort of context. But what we end up is with people with chronic occlusion, that is still somewhat controversial, and the optimal management and timing of revascularization is not really well established yet. And, in any cerebrovascular talk, it would be remiss without mentioning Dr. Yasergill, but he was one of the pioneers of bypass surgery, and he published that technique in 1967. The focus of this talk is going to be more for endovascular approaches for this type of pathology. And endovascular revascularization for this was reported by Tirada in 2005. And the four primary mechanisms by which vascular events occur is you have hyperperfusion, which is basically just not enough blood flow, not enough oxygen reaching the cortex. Now you have focal thrombosis. So focal thrombosis kind of refers to someone who has a dissection, and in that dissection flap ultimately leads to a thrombosis and an occlusion of that vessel. And thromboembolic kind of refers to almost like a stump syndrome. You have somebody who is occluded, but there is a small stump there, and there's tiny emboli that are dislodged and cause embolic events. And then you have occlusion of perforating vessels, and these are often like your collaterals that develop from with this chronic occlusion, you have neovascularization that occurs in that ischemic tissue, and some of those perforators, they occlude for one reason or another, whether it's hypotension, hyperperfusion, or some sort of micro embolus that occurs in that location. And so when we assess a patient who has a known occlusion, what we want to assess, and one of the more difficult things to determine, is what is their cerebrovascular reserve? So cerebrovascular reserve is probably the most important predictor of ischemic events. And what that tells us is how well is the patient compensating for this loss of circulation from one of the carotids. And there's several different methods that have been published in the literature. And the more mainstream methods, and a lot of what we do here, is we assess response to induction of cerebral vasodilation. And so how do we do that? We do that by increasing someone's CO2 by about 8 millimeters of mercury or more. And it's achieved by, you know, historically, it's been achieved by, you know, you have somebody doing multiple breath holds. If you look at the old school literature and, you know, assessing end-tidal CO2 and seeing that rise, we have a Respirac protocol where you have a titrated concentration of, 95% O2 and 5% CO2 that gradually will elevate someone's CO2. You can also supplement this with acetazolamide administration, and that induction of cerebral vasodilation will help elucidate asymmetry in perfusion. And that's the formula there for calculating someone's cerebrovascular reserve. And many different methods have been used and published, but the most practical has been MRI, and reliable has been MRI. Then we go to another factor, is someone's oxygen extraction fraction. And this is probably the most important indicator of need for recanalization. And unfortunately, it's probably the hardest to reliably assess. PET scanning in the literature is what they say is the gold standard method for measurement of this. But MRI techniques are starting to emerge. But basically, when somebody's oxygen extraction fraction starts to increase, with that is an indicator that they're starting to, they're impending failure, essentially. When we look at the stages of impairment of someone's cerebrovascular reserve, so stage zero, we kind of classify that as, they're unimpaired. One, you have normal hemodynamics. So someone's CVF and extraction fraction are preserved. You have adequate collaterals through a number of avenues. You have the contralateral ICA, and you have anterior communicating artery and posterior circulation also supplying via the posterior communicating artery. Stage two is what we call, misery perfusion. So you start to have inadequate collaterals. Your autoregulation starts to become exhausted. The brain, in essence, is becoming miserable. It's just the way I think about it. And your mean transit time increases, your CBF starts to decrease, and your oxygen extraction fraction starts to increase. And then stage three is just failure. You start to have signs and symptoms of ischemia, you have infarction, and that's because the CBF and OEF and collaterals are at the point where they cannot meet the metabolic demand. And so when we talk about the clinical presentation, I like to kind of think of four wheels of a car here. So you have two arteries in the front, the carotids, two arteries in the back, the vertebral arteries. You can see this picture here, if anyone's an F1 fan. Lewis Hamilton won the British Grand Prix on three tires in the final lap. you know, he was driving 140 miles per hour on three wheels, which was, you know, something to see. But that's kind of how I liken this to some people who are starting to, you know, they're performing, you know, they're asymptomatic, questionably teetering on the edge. And then ultimately, you know, they're maintaining until eventually something gives, you know, they're no longer able to, you know, if he had kept going, eventually, you know, he would have, his car would have, you know, been completely trashed. So I kind of liken that similar analogy to the way our vessels work. Somebody is asymptomatic. They may start to show subtle signs of impairment. And I think that's the area that we are struggling to capture. Who should we treat in these situations? Obviously, I think it's pretty well established that people with recurrent neurological symptoms and people with intracranial occlusion, signs of infarct, they for sure need treatment. It's the latter two, excuse me, the former two that we need to elucidate a little bit more. So the different strategies of management for these patients, medical management obviously is the first line. You have monotherapy versus dual antiplatelet therapy. And then there's anticoagulation, depending on the patient's progression of symptoms and their other medical comorbidities. Carotid artery has also been very well established for carotid stenosis, not very well established for carotid occlusion. And bypass, we'll talk a little bit more about the evidence for that, but those are also other options. You have direct and indirect. You have direct EC to IC bypass, STA to MCA, or even like a high flow bypass, such as using the internal maxillary artery. Indirect, you have EDAS, EDAMs, and then you have pleosynangiosis as well. So the endovascular approaches, carotid angioplasty and stenting with flow reversal or flow arrest. And then another technique that's also been discussed is a combination of carotid and endarterectomy plus carotid artery stenting. That's been starting to gain more popularity in the literature, and especially in China and Japan, that is noted in the literature. So for endovascular recanalization, as I mentioned before, Tirada published the first successful recanalization of a chronic occlusion in 2005. And this was performed under flow reversal. It was an older generation technology, not like what they use with TCAR now, but he later published a series where in 15 patients, he achieved successful recanalization in 14 of them. And this is also followed up with more successful reports of recanalization. Cao et al. In 2007 reported 22 out of 30 patients achieved recanalization from an endovascular approach. And he had a restenosis rate of 3 out of 22. However, one patient did have a fatal brainstem infarct, which it was not really described in the paper what the etiology of that was, although they did say their stent was patent on the follow-up study. So just a little about the controversies in management. So the COST trial, this was a trial discussing bypass in the setting of carotid occlusion. This was published in 2011. It was stopped prematurely due to futility. And this was because medical management was found to be in their study superior essentially to bypass surgery. And this was much like Aruba did to AVM surgery. This is what the study did for bypass in this patient population. It definitely fell out of favor. But when you really deep dive into kind of the controversy surrounding this study, I think there was a lot of technical errors and a lot of different aspects of how bypasses were done that led to the discrepancy in results, because When you talk to any neurosurgeon, you know that bypass does work. It's just it probably needs to be done in a technically skilled way, and people who do it more often than not. I brought up the Sampras trial here, and I think this is the clearest surrogate for me, because there's not really a lot of randomized, there's not any randomized trials for this endovascular approach for carotid occlusion. But if Sampras looked at intracranial stenosis and stenting versus medical management, and you can see here that the medical management had much better stroke rate compared to angioplasty and stenting. And again, this is some of the related to the technology, devices, and techniques that were available at that time compared to now. And I think there's going to be more research down the pipeline that will show that the rates are almost equivocal. And then the largest case series for chronic occlusion was published by Chen et al. And that was, they had a 61.6% success rate. And a couple things about their study were that 43% of those patients were asymptomatic, 4.3% complication rate. And if you look at the AHA guidelines, for patients who are asymptomatic, they want you to have a complication rate of 3% or less. And this is a kind of a table summarizing. You can see that these are the series published in the literature. Chen had a series of 138, but if you look at all the different studies there, the next highest total is 33. And probably you would see that about a 70% success rate when it comes to overall a successful recanalization and good outcomes. So who are the asymptomatic, quote unquote, patients? I say asymptomatic because these are people who I would say are kind of go under the radar. They show subtle signs of cognitive impairment. They show subtle neurological findings due to lack of cerebral blood flow from a missing entire carotid artery. And this is the patient population where more and more data is coming out that revascularization, despite being quote unquote asymptomatic, really does improve neurocognitive outcomes in people who are chronically hyperperfused. And so this, in this study here, by Lin et al, 10 of 12 patients were able to achieve a successful revascularization, and they had significant improvement in various cognitive scores. You can see that they had a Alzheimer's disease scale, MMSE, and a test called the color trail making scale. They used multiple tests, and all patients who achieved recanalization had statistically significant improvements in their performance on those scores. And this is another study that also people, 14 out of the 22 patients, only patients who had abnormal perfusion imaging experienced the statistically significant cognitive benefits. So even, so the good thing about this study was that they took into account who were actually showing signs of abnormal perfusion and correlating that to the outcome. So that was another good article showing who should, really who might benefit from something like this. And this is another one more recently published as well, using the Montreal Cognitive Scale. And all five patients from this in their personal case series experienced an improvement in resolution of the hyperperfusion. And then they did a literature review of 333 patients and found a 70% recanalization rate and 3.9% major and 2.97% minor complication rate, which, as I mentioned, you know, this becomes a little tricky when you reconcile that with the complication rate that the AHA, the stroke guidelines, want you to stay under for asymptomatic patients. But it does show that neurocognition is improved in patients who have hyperperfusion and occlusion on that side. And some predictors on the technical aspect of this, you know, predictors of who is going to have a successful outcome, those have been published. And these are two different typing systems. One on the right, Dr. Talk was actually a part of. You can see, like, the type A, you have kind of a tapered stump, and you have clear avenue into the internal carotid artery. Type B, you don't really have a taper, but there's a clear ICA stump there. Type C and D, these are the ones that are on the more difficult scale, because you don't really have a clear ICA stump. There's no real taper leading to it. And in addition, with type D, you don't really see any ECA collaterals. In the other types, you have collaterals from EC, IC anastomoses, particularly through the ethmoidals leading through the ophthalmic. And then you also have the PCOMs and the ACOMs as well. So things that in the literature have been documented to have predictors of success. Cervical location of the occlusion, a retrograde flow from ECA collaterals, a tapered stump, a length of less than 5 centimeters. And then ideally, you don't want anybody that has been within a month of the diagnosis. It helps to we assess stability and whether they're truly symptomatic from it. Obviously, if they're having really disabling symptoms, trying to address it would be the most appropriate course of action. So some illustrative cases here to kind of bring this home. So this first case, we have a 63-year-old who's referred with recurrent left leg weakness that has improved. And his recent ED visit demonstrated punctate DWI changes, and he had been recently taken off his Eliquis. His aspirin, his Plavix was found to be subtherapeutic. He was subsequently switched to Brilinta. So this is the MRI showing the punctate DWI changes there. And then he has a CTA demonstrating, you can see his right ICA is occluded. You can see maybe a trickle of something, but that is not really real. Here is his angiogram here. You can see the retrograde flow into the ICA via the external anastomoses. And then you can see he's somebody who's been, this is a left ICA injection. You can see a lot of his circulation and his left vert. He has been getting a lot of collateral flow from the opposite side, but now what's happening with him is it's, you know, starting to decompensate essentially. And he's starting to have these symptoms coming from this occluded segment. So for this patient, he was previously offered a TCAR by an outside facility, but he came to us for a second opinion. So an endovascular approach was offered, and he underwent a transfemoral approach with proximal flow arrest with the MoMA device, which you can see in this picture here. The MoMA is essentially a catheter that has two balloons, one at the distal end that goes into the external carotid artery and you inflate it. And then it has a proximal balloon that inflates in the common carotid artery, and that induces flow arrest. Then you also have no reflux from the external carotid artery. And he had a, specifically underwent a successful stenting, and he has remained asymptomatic since that time. You can see here, stent in place and restoration of flow there. The second case is a bit of a unique case, and is an 84-year-old. He had presented with right-sided visual loss 6 months prior and was found to have severe left carotid disease. He was initially offered a CEA at an outside facility. However, his platelet count was 50,000 and the procedure was canceled. So he came to us for further management. And you can see here, this patient, he has a probably type A here, is a tapered stump. And you can see there's retrograde flow from the ECAs there. And not much, nothing going intracranially. It's like functionally, this patient is occluded. And so again, he was another patient that underwent a endovascular approach, which it became very, when somebody who has a platelet count of 50,000, what is truly the best approach for them? They're gonna be on dual antiplatelets. They're gonna get heparinized during the procedure. Open surgery versus endovascular, they're both not without risk. And so he also underwent proximal flow arrest. He was able to get successful recanalization of this artery with restoration of intracranial flow, you can see there. He was kept on a low dose heparin drip overnight. He was very slow to start. He was on aspirin and heparin, and then was started on a Plavix after it was his growing site was noted to be stable, and he was not having any signs of a bleeding complication. And so this third case, I think, is illustration of somebody who is going from that stage two to stage three, from like they're slowly, going from that misery perfusion to, complete failure. And it was interesting to see this type of presentation in real time. You can see he's a 63-year-old presented with right facial droop, right sided weakness, NIH 11. And you can see he has no evidence of filling in the ICA there. And you trace that down to the cervical region. And okay. I think my presentation just froze there. I apologize. So the patient, yeah. You go back. Okay. Okay, so he had evidence of hyperperfusion on that the left hemisphere there, with increased Tmax and increased mean transit time. So interesting about his presentation, somebody with a left ICA occlusion should be significantly worse than an NIH 11. After the imaging was completed, he improved to essentially an NIH of 1. and then after orthostatic testing about 30 minutes later, his symptoms returned. So he was taken urgently for endovascular intervention. He was treated, we used a balloon guide catheter. And what you can see here is you have that non-tapered stump there and no clear path to the internal carotid artery. And so this is us, this is an illustration of trying to take the microwire and access the artery and eventually, poking and prodding. These are technically frustrating procedures. You have to be very patient and scale up. Some people will talk about using very stiff wires, back of a glide wire. And those are the things that, do work, but they also increase your risk for potential complication if you get too frustrated and try to force the issue too much. So after we were able to get distal access, we were able to get a balloon across to dilate the proximal ICA, and we were able to get an aspiration catheter across. And there was noted to be a left M1 clot here, where we were able to get a stent retriever across to perform a thrombectomy. And then here, as we were coming out, you could clearly see that the ICA was reoccluding as we were working. And so serial angioplasty was performed and stent was deployed acutely in that setting. And so he received, you know, the acute loading dose of Plavix, aspirin rectally, and then he also got Aggrastat IA intra-arterially and intravenously. And he improved to NIHCO the following day and did extremely well, all things considered. So to summarize kind of how we select patients for this, you know, RAD, people who just don't offer immediate treatment, people who are truly asymptomatic, they show no signs of impairment, just maximize medical management. Those who maybe show subtle signs, you know, how can we detect this? It's very important that you have good neurologists who know the signs, you have involved families who know the signs, and they can conduct the appropriate testing. Without the appropriate testing, oftentimes these things are missed. And a couple benchmarks potentially to set, you know, someone with a MoCA of less than 26 or MMSE of mini mental status exam of less than 24. And it's important that it's in the setting of hyperperfusion as well. Otherwise, you know, these could be more organic things that are not related to, you know, the circulation. And then obviously, as we mentioned, treatment green light is indicated for, you know, recurrent neurological symptoms, someone with like a stump syndrome, or somebody who develops a complete intracranial occlusion with you know, hyperperfusion and potentially disabling or lasting deficits. And to define, again, hyperperfusion, you have a reduced CBF in response to cerebral vasodilation challenge with increased transit time and increased oxygen extraction fraction. And then obviously endovascular patients, people who are poor surgical candidates, often endovascular may be their only chance. Somebody with a platelet of 50 and you can't get them above 50, maybe endovascular is the only chance they have. Maybe a transradial approach to try and address this, if their anatomy is suitable, is something that is their only chance. So in summary, that's it. I just thank the neurovascular team, Dr. Talk, Dr. Fox, Miller, and Wynn, and then my partner in crime, Dr. Wad, for helping me through this year. References, and then I think I saw Dr. Fox on, if you have any comments or anything to add, or anyone else from the neurovascular team.
Hey, Samir, how are you?
We're here.
Yeah, good talk. Tough topic. And I mean, in terms of treating these patients, knowing exactly what to do, very challenging. Lots of stuff in the literature that, to be honest, kind of puts us in a place where we're painted into a corner sometimes. But we do see patients who have recurrent symptoms and are not doing well with medical management. And I think, you know, this is more just a comment, but I like how you you touched on the various options and ways to try to narrow this down and who's best being treated. I think it's important that we really consider, you know, in all of our practices, trying to identify the patients who we can best help and we have the least amount of likelihood to hurt. If I think back to when Wingspan came out and everyone started just throwing Wingspan in every time there was an intracranial atherosclerotic lesion. And what ended up happening was a lot of patients didn't do well in that device, which we know works very well in the right patient, almost was completely banned from being used. I mean, not used. It was almost completely taken off the market, which would have been a disservice to patients. So I think, you know, making sure we have very clear indications using the literature that we have, using some of the newer diagnostic tools like bold studies, trying to look at the overall balance of cerebral metabolism will help us choose these patients. And then, you know, on top of that, like you mentioned, there's lots of new device technology out there to help us with these sorts of lesions that we could only imagine treating endovascularly only a few years ago. So really nice job putting that all together. And thanks for your talk.
Thank you.
Great talk, Samir. I think you touched base on the main things for this topic. And I think personally that this is a little bit of an abandoned topic because this is an area of a lot of gray zones that was built on failure of major trials, basically. But if you look at it, the fact is some patients need it and you have to do it. And from my perspective, it's a way better option than a bypass, because the bypass, I'm putting a 2 millimeter vessel, 1 millimeter vessel. This one is really restoring carotid circulation to the whole hand. And cases when it's successful, it's really good. And you touched base on the techniques. I think the when it extends intracranially, I don't try it basically, but as long as it's extracranial, I don't hesitate to try it when needed for those patients. And you have the acute versus chronic. In the acute, I think we solve it out. It's all indications for stroke intervention. The subacute are tough because you have a clot in the vessel, and then if you recanalize it, you can embolize it. The chronic ones, most of them are fibrotic, like there's no clots in the vessel. So that's how I divide it. But I like your classification, when you do it, when you shouldn't do it. So nice job.
Yeah, I would add that, you know, it's a fascinating topic. You know, we have all kinds of people who walk into our offices all the time with one carotid occluded and them never having known that. It happens for trauma, it happens through atherosclerosis, et cetera, et cetera. Many people don't end up with symptoms, but there are subtle symptoms which you touched on well. And we also know that sometimes a chronically occluded carotid spontaneously recanalize. So we know that in some patients, there seems to be a demand there. They actually recanalize and patients do well. It's not common, but you see it every now and then. So then it really is knowing that there are some, especially the neurocognitive changes, there are subtle things that some patients suffer from. There are patients who would benefit from being recanalized. But the question is who, what that population is, and you know, how and what the risks are to doing so. And I think your talk touched on all of those things. So it was a really good review of that, and we appreciate it. It's still a tough topic, but as Dr. Fox and Dr. Talkin mentioned, you know, there are lots of alternatives now, and I think that these patients deserve being reviewed and in some cases deserve the treatment.
You know, great talk. You know, this really doesn't have much to do about this, but, you know, I was really interested in that second case and how you guys manage patients that obviously considerably need to be on antiplatelets and then also has low thrombocytopenia. How do you guys go about dealing with that and determining which way to go for those patients?
Yeah, I mean, if it's anything I learned from Dr. Fox, let's go radial first. I mean, the radial approach for the thrombocytopenic patients is like a go-to in my mind. I mean, that's always gonna be my first option. But for something like carotid stenting, it's very difficult because you need a larger bore, you need a larger French catheter system, and then the access, like especially if it's a left carotid, and sometimes the angles to the right carotid make it difficult. But that would be the first step. But if you have to go transfemoral, just be judicious and careful about how aggressively you do it. And I think in that second case, you know, we did a heparin infusion along with aspirin overnight after he got loaded with 600 aspirin. I think that was a good call just to say, if, you know, if he does develop any bleeding complications, you can easily reverse it. You can give protamine and then kind of readdress it again at that time. But I think if you ask all four different of our faculty, they probably give you four different answers on how they would go about it in that type of setting.
Yeah, and carrying that on, Kingsley, the running a month or two of dual antiplatelet therapy in somebody with markedly reduced platelets is a challenge. It becomes very tricky. Sometimes, Plavix, depending on what kind of a responder the patient is, Plavix allows you some ability to play with your P2Y12. So you can, Brilinta is extremely effective. It works pretty completely as soon as you give the medication. With some people who are not as good responders or as, significant responders to Plavix, you can sort of try to play with the medication and keep the P2Y12 towards the minimum effective dose, as opposed to something like Brilinta, which markedly reduces their platelet function. So you kind of have to play with it, but those patients are a challenge, and sometimes you end up monitoring them much more closely and monitoring their platelet activity a lot more closely in the time that you need. The good thing about the carotid is that, unlike intracranial things, you don't need nearly as long a period of dual antiplatelet after the stent is placed because of the larger diameter of the vessel. But yeah, you're right. It's a real challenge in some of these patients. So you said, and sometimes you again, if in those patients with that kind of a thing, you may be a better option may be to give them a platelet transfusion, do a surgical procedure, do it open as opposed to endovascular, and then you don't have the issues of long-term dual antiplatelet therapy in somebody who's going to be chronically platelet deficient.
There is no guideline, but definitely those people need adjustment of our anticoagulation, because going back, I mean, if I have to remember my case and the complications is whenever you have thrombocytopenia, because our standard of care is aspirin, Plavix, and heparin, and then that's for people with normal platelets, but there's nothing in the literature that says anything how you adjust for thrombocytopenic patients. And going back for my patients, the complications I had have been several of them on those patients. So it's definitely a high risk population. Yeah, so I go halfway on those sometimes. I just don't give the full thing.
Yeah, I think that continues to be a challenge throughout all of neurosurgery, certainly in spine, and I know certainly in vascular for you guys as well. This was a great talk, and Samir, really nice presentation, and really want to thank everybody for joining us this morning. And if anyone, unless there's any other comments, I'd like to say have a great start to your week.
All right. Thank you. Have a good day.
Well done, Samir. Thank you.